Good morning, children. Welcome back to our online section. Today we will start with third chapter in macroeconomics, that is chapter number 3, determination of income and employment. So this chapter includes three parts. First one, aggregate demand and supply. Second one, determination of income and employment. And third one, excess demand and deficit demand. So this chapter is very much important and has very much weightages of mark. So you have to study this chapter very well. So let's start with aggregate demand. Classical theory of income and employment. So classical economists are Adam Smith, David Ricardo and J.B. Say, etc. They developed the theoretical framework for determination of income, output and employment. So J.B. Say, an early 19th century French economist, introduced his famous theory, that is known as Say's law of market. According to this law, the supply creates its own demand. What do you mean by that? Therefore, there cannot be overproduction and unemployment in the economy. They believed market mechanism, that is demand and supply, which automatically established equilibrium between total demand and total supply in the economy. So this mechanism is known as invisible hand. Okay? Then overproduction and unemployment arises only in the short period. In the long run, the economy will automatically tend towards full employment when the demand and supply of goods become equal. So when a producer produces goods and pay wages to worker, the worker in turn buy those goods in the market. Thus, every act of supplying or producing goods implies a demand for them. So, in this way, supply creates its own demand. So, every supply of goods and services will create their own demand. So, classical economists believed in full employment. The economy always in full employment. There is no need of government intervention because the demand and supply automatically generated equilibrium. Okay. So this absence of government intervention policy is known as laissez-faire policy. Then demand and supply will automatically establish equilibrium. Then the economists believed in this theory till 1930. What happened after 1930? So, during the Great Depression of 1930, that is the classical theory of income and employment failed. According to classical theory, there is no possibility of overproduction and underproduction. But during 1930, world faced a Great Depression of underproduction. And it led to massive unemployment and falling income. At this time, J.M. Keynes, John Maynard Keynes, introduced his famous theory in his book the General Theory of Employment, Interest and Money in 1935 and also introduced the concept of effective demand. Okay, he gave more importance to demand, but classical economists were given more importance to supply. That is the difference between classical theory and Keynesian theory. So he had used the approach of aggregate demand and aggregate supply for the determination of income and employment. So now we are going to study about Keynesian theory of income and employment in details. So he had used aggregate demand and aggregate supply. So first of all, aggregate demand. Aggregate demand refers to the total demand for goods and services in an economy in an accounting year. That is total expenditure made by all the sectors in an economy. So we had studied in national income accounting, in an economy, who will increase expenditure or who will incur expenditure? Yes, household, firms, government and rest of the world. And also we studied that one's expenditure is others' income.
The expenditure incurred by household sector on the purchase of goods and services become the income of firm. Then expenditure of the firm on production, factors of production is the income of households. So students, just recall the circular flow of income, how the income is circulated among the two factors or four factors of economy. Okay, then according to Keynes, aggregate demand as the sum of total of revenue which all the entrepreneurs in an economy expected to receive from the sale of their products at given level of employment. I repeat, according to Keynes, aggregate demand as the sum of total revenue which all the entrepreneurs in the economy expected to receive from the sale of their product at given level of employment. According to this definition, aggregate demand is the expected revenue, not actual revenue. That is, there is any distinction between expected value and actual value? Yes, of course. So for understanding this concept, we have to study the meaning of ex ante and ex post. We have already studied about this concept in first chapter. So, ex ante value, which means planned, anticipated or estimated or expected or intended or unrealized value. That is the ex ante value. In our theoretical explanation, we always take this value, that is expected value. Then what about the ex post value? Exposed value, which means actual or realized value, and they are more of the result of the policies and government intervention. So for example, suppose for the examination you expected 90% mark, but after the examination you may get 95 mark or you may get 85 marks. So here 90% mark is the ex ante value. Then what you are really get is the ex post value. Okay students, so Keynes had stressed on ex ante or expected value of total demand, not actual value. He gave more importance to ex ante. Okay, that is anticipated or estimated or expected value of total demand. Next is the components of aggregate demand. There are four major components of aggregate demand, which are household consumption expenditure, C, that is expected expenditure incurred by household on consumption of final goods and services. Then total consumption expenditure or total consumption demand may be private consumption expenditure and public consumption expenditure. Then the next one, private and public invest expenditure. So the expenditure incurred by the firm or producer on capital good is known as investment expenditure. So the investment demand may be from the side of private producer or from the government. So it is also an ex ante value or also an estimated capital formation. Then third one, government final consumption expenditure. So it comprises the ex ante expenditure by the government. Then the last one is net export, that is the difference between export and import. So planned net export is the part of aggregate demand. So aggregate demand is equal to consumption demand plus investment demand. Then aggregate demand or aggregate expenditure is equal to consumption expenditure plus investment expenditure. So a demand is mainly determined by the four factors. So AD, in four sector model, AD, aggregate demand is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. But we have taken two sector model. So in two sector model, aggregate demand is equal to consumption expenditure plus investment expenditure. So let us study more about this component of aggregate demand. First of all, aggregate consumption expenditure. Okay, so consumption expenditure depends upon the level of income and propensity to consume. So the level of income, the consumption of a household or economy depends upon its income. They have positive relation. That is, if income increases, consumption also increases. So we can written as C is the function of income. C is the F of Y means C is the function of income. Then the second factor is propensity to consume. It is very important concern. What do you mean by propensity to consume? It is that proportion of the income which depends on the tendency of the consumer to spend his income. Okay. So, the level of consumption to the level of income. That is known as propensity to consume. Then, how much the consumption would change with the change in income of the household? Then, according to Keynes, income of an individual rises. He preferred to save more and consume less. This is known as Keynesian psychological law of consumption. So, what is the Keynesian psychological law of consumption? According to Keynes, income of an individual rises. He preferred to save more and consume less. Thus, definitely consumption increases with an increase in income, but the proportion may not be same as the increase in income. So, increase in a consumption as a result to increase in income is determined by propensity to consume. There are two types of propensity: average propensity to consume and marginal propensity to consume, APC and MPC. So, APC, what do you mean by APC? It is defined as the ratio between total income and total consumption. Okay. That is, APC is equal to total consumption divided by total income, or APC is equal to C by Y. C is the total consumption, Y is the total income. So, APC can be calculated by C by Y. Then, next is the marginal propensity to consume, MPC. Marginal means addition or change in one variable due to change in other variable. That is known as marginal. Then the marginal propensity to consume is the relationship between change in consumption with respect to a given change in the income. So, MPC is equal to delta C by delta Y. Here delta means change. Then delta C is equal to C2 minus C1, and delta Y is equal to Y2 minus Y1. And here C2 means new consumption level, C1 means original level of consumption. So, delta C is equal to C2 minus C1. Then delta Y is equal to what? What do you mean by delta Y? That is, delta Y is equal to Y2 minus Y1. That is, Y2 is the new level of income. That is, change in income. Then, Y1 is the original level of income. So, delta Y is equal to Y2 minus Y1. So, MPC is equal to C2 minus C1 divided by Y2 minus Y1. Okay? So, MPC is equal to delta C divided by delta Y. Then delta C is equal to C2 minus C1. Delta Y is equal to Y2 minus Y1. So, MPC is equal to C2 minus C1 divided by Y2 minus Y1. These are the two types of propensity. So, income is the function of, consumption is the function of income. So, the relationship between consumption and income is known as consumption functions. Okay, we can explain it with the help of a diagram. Here is the x-axis represent income, y-axis represent consumption. So, consumption is the function of income. So, it initiated from the origin. So, consumption curve initiated from the origin. Here is the origin. Then, a straight line from the point of origin at 45 degree between two axes given. All these point on this line indicate the consumption is equal to income. So the entire income is used for consumption. Then this 45 degree line shows the perfect positive correlation between income and consumption expenditure. Okay, then the slope of consumption curve is the marginal propensity to consume. Positive relation means if income increases, consumption also increases accordingly. Okay, students.